is Chris from Cotton Boot, and I'm here with the new Nokia 5 Android phone, which is just launched here in the UK. So you can pick it up now for about 180 quid. So nice little price considering the specs. And of course, one of its biggest rivals right now is the Moto G5 from Motorola, which at £169 is ever so slightly cheaper. It packs very, very similar specs. So we're just going to do a quick side-by-side and see which might be best for you. So in terms of dimensions and everything, there's not a massive amount in it. As you can see, the Nokia is a slightly taller handset than the Moto. It's a 5.2-inch compared to 5 inches, but in terms of the overall dimensions, there's not really that much in it at all. They're about the same in terms of width, in terms of thickness, and all the rest of it as well. Very little in it. The Nokia is definitely the heftier phone. It's about 160 grams compared to 145. Doesn't sound like much of a difference, but you can definitely notice that it's got more of a heft to it when you're wielding it as so. But in terms of the general design as well, they're both aluminium handsets. You can pick them up in a variety of colors, slightly more choice than Nokia. You can pick it up in a salmony color, for instance, whereas it's silver or gold only for the Moto. As you can see, the Moto is scratched up a little bit these days. I'd like to just point out that was not my doing whatsoever, but it's generally pretty hardy. It can take a fair bit of punishment, so God knows what's happened to this thing. Nokia, we've only been testing it for a very short while, but we'll be testing out its hardiness as well to see just how resistant it is. It's not water resistant or anything, sadly. You don't get anything like that thrown in, but it does seem to be sort of splash proof at the very least, so that's always nice to have. In terms of that design as well, as you can see, it's a unibody on the Nokia, so that metal stretches all the way around the edges. There's no lines or anything to break it up. All the banding is at the top and the bottom, which is lovely to have. On the Motorola, it's more of a joined up design, as you can see here. It does actually have a bit of chromey plastic rim action just along the edges there, which unfortunately does seem to cheapen it a little bit, at least in our eyes. You might have your own personal opinion on that, but we definitely prefer the sleekness of the Nokia compared with the Moto. But it is still a step up from the plastic fantastic models of yesteryear, so it's definitely good to have a bit of metal in the design there now. Just makes it feel that little bit more premium than those previous handsets. Both phones rock a fingerprint sensor, which are built into the home button beneath the displays. And in both cases, they're perfectly fine. They do the job. They're not particularly nippy, but as you can see, we just tap the off prints to it. The Motorola is slightly faster, but both are pleasingly responsive and both definitely make a nice alternative to pins and all the rest of it, which is good as well. So what about the screens? Well, as I say, it's a 5.2-incher, the Nokia, compared with the 5-inch Moto. So not much difference in terms of the actual dimensions, but in terms of resolution, there is a big difference. The Motorola Moto G5 is a full HD 1920x1080 pixel resolution screen, whereas the Nokia, unfortunately, is a 720p, so it's 1280x720 pixel resolution. So there is a difference in terms of image quality. You can just about notice individual pixels if you're getting really close to the Nokia. Whereas you don't get that on the Moto G5, especially as it's a slightly more compact display as well. It makes it even crisper, but still both are perfectly fine, just for, you know, watching a bit of movies on the go, a bit of Netflix or something like that. And as you can see there, we've got the same background on both handsets. In terms of general vibrancy and the rest, there's not really any difference either. They're both perfectly bright on top brightness. Viewing angles are fine and all the rest of it as well. And they're both IPS displays, so that's basically explaining away why they're both sort of similar levels of color reproduction and the rest. So if you want something to just watch a bit of YouTube, a bit of Netflix on the go, you know what, the Nokia will still do the job, even though it's just 720p. If you dive into the display settings of both of them as well, you'll notice that neither of them, unfortunately, have any kind of night mode or anything like that. So there's no blue light filter for a more comfortable night viewing experience. But they both do have adaptive brightness and the rest, all the basic features that you would expect. So what about that OS? Well, it's Android Nougat in both cases. If you dive into the Nokia settings, you'll notice that's the latest version, 7.1.1. Whereas, sadly, the Moto is on a slightly older version, 7.0, hasn't been updated just yet. We're still waiting for that. But in both cases, it's a pleasingly clean version of Android, as you'll see here. It's basically as Google intended, pretty much. There is no overlay on the top of it. You get into your apps tray just with a quick tap of that or a swipe up. And as you can see there, you scroll through, get all your different apps. And there's all the usual support for app permissions and all the rest of it as well, which is good. So you've got full control over what your apps can see or do. And if you dive into the settings, you get plenty of customization thrown in there, as you would expect. As usual, you can check out your battery usage and all the rest of it. You've got a battery saver mode on both these handsets, and they both rock a very similar battery size as well. It's 3000 milliamp on the Nokia, 2800 on the Moto, and they both support a form of quick charge as well. Quick charge 3.0 on this bad boy, and it supports a fast charge as well. So you can get a majority of a charge it with just an hour at the plug, which is always good if you forget to charge it overnight and you need to get it powered up a bit for the commute and all the rest of it. Definitely a good feature to have. As for the general performance, it's a Snapdragon 430 chipset in both of these handsets, backed by 2 gigs of RAM. You can get the Moto G5 in 3 gigs as well if you decide to upscale. In both cases, they're both perfectly nippy. You know, apps load up without much of a delay, as you can see there. It's perfectly good for your everyday tasks, so you won't be hanging around waiting for things to happen. And we haven't seen any crashes or stutters or anything just yet on the Nokia, so fingers crossed that will steer the course for that one. And we've also run AnTuTu benchmarking on both of these phones as well. And unsurprisingly, given the similar chipset arrangement and all the rest of it, you get very, very similar scores around the 45,000 mark each time. So that's perfectly good, again, for your everyday usage. You'll probably see a bit of slowdown over time with both these handsets, but because of that nice vanilla version of Android, there's no heavy overlay cluttering things up and slowing things down. Hopefully, should be absolutely fine for the length of a contract, which is obviously the most important thing. Although they're both vanilla versions of Android, Motorola has actually added its own Moto Assistant to the Moto G5. So it just has some basic gesture support. So for instance, you can do a quick double twist to launch the camera app, which is a handy thing indeed. You can also shrink the screen down, which is a kind of a handy one-handed mode. So all you need to do is kind of swipe it like that. There you go. And now everything shrunk down towards the bottom of the screen, and it's that much easier to play around with. So that's something that's unique to the Moto phones. You don't get that in the Nokia handset. However, one area where the Nokia does beat the Moto is NFC. This comes with full NFC support. As you'll see, if we pull this down here, you can toggle that in the settings. So if we dive into here, there you go, full NFC support. So it's switched off at the moment, but that can be activated for contactless payments and quick transfer of files and all the rest of it. Something you don't get, sadly, in the Moto G. That feature is completely missing in action, which is a bit of a shame. So no contactless payment support or any of that. When it comes to storage, however, both handsets are basically the same. You get 16 gigs of storage in both cases, which unfortunately is mostly taken up by the actual OS and the rest of it. On the Nokia, as you can see here, 7.71 gigs, that's before we've added much in the way of our own apps. I've literally put AnTuTu on it and a couple of other bits, and that's it. So you only get about sort of 8 gigs to play around with on the Nokia. Thankfully, it's not quite so bad on the Moto, but you still only get about sort of 9 gigs for your own stuff, so it's not great. Thankfully, both phones also support micro SD memory cards, so it's in the bottom tray here on the Nokia, which handily isn't marked, so that can be a bit confusing when you're first trying to get your SIM card set up and everything. And you can actually prise open the Moto, as you can see here. Let's pull this bad boy apart. And as you can see, you can slip a micro SD memory card in there in order to expand. It's actually better support on the Nokia. It's up to 256 gig cards, whereas it's only 128 on the Moto G5. So you get more room for expandability on the Nokia. Which brings us nicely onto the camera tech. So in both cases, very, very similar setup again. You get a 13 megapixel rear camera. As you see there, nice sort of clean interfaces. Again, not been much tinkering by Motorola or Nokia. You get face detection, autofocus in both cases, and they're both f2.0 aperture lenses as well, so should prove absolutely fine for your night photos and the rest of it. And you can shoot up to full HD video as well at 30 frames per second. As you can see, just a nice clean interface. It's got quite a fast autofocus in both cases. You can also tap to focus, of course, if you so desire. You get more manual controls on the Moto, as we'll see if you tap into here, you get full manual controls. So you can play around with the likes of white balance and the rest of it, or you can just, of course, stick to the full auto mode, which is, I'm guessing, what the majority of people will do. It's a perfectly fine auto mode, does a good job in the majority of conditions, pretty fast shutter speeds, apart from on this occasion for some reason, it's it's gone crazy. Excellent. Let's try that again. There we go, that's what I was expecting. You got full HDR mode on both handsets as well, and of course the usual timer, gubbins, and a bit of flash action as well. You get a two-tone LED flash on both of these handsets, which is lovely stuff. And a basic range of settings as well. You can just pull it out here on the Motorola. As you can see, you just add like a grid to it, play with the GPS settings and all that kind of stuff. It's a very similar thing on the Nokia. It's just very basic settings, the kind of stuff you'd expect. You can just, you know, change the shutter noise and all the rest of it again. So the, as I say, no manual controls that I could find, at least on the Nokia. You just get a beautify mode and panorama mode. Whereas on here, you get the manual controls as well as time lapse, panorama, and of course you can shoot up to full HD video on both of these bad boys, which is always good to have. With digital image stabilization as well. So check out our full samples and everything on Recombi's YouTube channel if you want to see a bit of the samples in action. And in terms of the front-facing cameras, you get a 5-megapixel on the Moto G5 wide aperture lens and an 8-megapixel on the Nokia, so slightly sharper resolution on the Nokia 5. And that, in a nutshell, is the Nokia 5 versus the Moto G5. As you can see, they're very similar in terms of specs. Design is quite different, however. And of course, you get a few little different features. You get the Moto Assistant on the Moto G5, whereas you get NFC, which is always good to have on the Nokia. And in terms of the camera controls, they're slightly different, although the underlying hardware is very similar indeed. So if you've got any questions, comments, queries, etc., etc., shoot us up in the comments below.